Good morning. Here are our announcements for the week following Sunday, April 3rd. Our next Pillars meal is Tuesday, April 12th. In addition to serving volunteers, we are in need of meatballs and garlic bread to be donated. Typically, we serve about 60 people. Spring is in the air, and with that, we are looking for lawn mowing volunteers. Let me know if you're willing to help on a rotating basis. Feeling crafty? Sunday, April 10th from noon to 5, crafty friends will meet here at church. Bring your own project to work on. The next Ruby's Pantry is Tuesday, April 5th. All are welcome and the cost is $20 per box. Looking for a way to serve your church? Our worship volunteer sign up is now available online through the website or click on the link in the newsletter. Holy Week is coming quickly and we will have a variety of worship times available. Please see our newsletter for dates and times of these services. Our newsletter is packed with information for our church and community. It is delivered on Thursdays to your email. If you did not receive it, please let us know. Call our office here at church at 920-788-6492. Have a good week.
Everyone. My name is Carrie Bean, and I serve on the church council, and I also serve on our reentry task force for the COVID times that we are living in. And I'm so excited to see all of you here. It is wonderful that we are having more and more people come each week. And the reentry task force met on Tuesday this past week. And we are so happy to say that on Wednesday, we'll be moving some of our chairs a little closer on this side in preparation for Holy Week. We're still cognizant there are people that are wanting to be distanced and wanting to be a little further apart from the people that may not be wearing a mask and singing, so we're going to keep some of our spaces over here distanced. So I think on Wednesday, we'll be looking for a few strong arms, and you don't have to be particularly strong to lift one chair. So after worship on Wednesday, we'll be seeing a little shift in our space for making some more room for people. So as I said, we're super thankful that more people are coming, and with more people, we're having more opportunities to have our communion elements blessed, to have more people greeting, to have more people ushering, and all of that takes a little bit more manpower and woman power and kid power. So we're looking for more and more volunteers. We're hearing, you know, that it's more comfortable sometimes to stay at home and to stay online. I get that. I might have worshipped in my pajamas during the pandemic. And we're just so grateful, though, that there are some people that are stepping up, and we're looking for more and more people. So as I am at the welcoming desk, I have the sign-up genius ready for you if you would like to sign up there, if you'd like to go on. One of our members said it was so much easier when we were just scheduled. We would just put the schedule on, and we knew that every 6 weeks we were going to be the worship host, or we knew we were going to start fellowship, which is something that we're hearing that people would like, is to have some fellowship time and have maybe some coffee served. Wouldn't that be amazing? But all of this takes people. So we're asking that you maybe commit to every 6 weeks to bring your family and to serve the coffee here rather than your pajamas watching worship at your houses. So please prayerfully consider adding yourself to a schedule, making yourself have a schedule, or contacting Tina if you're not comfortable with the sign-up genius, or I can help you back at the welcome desk after worship. So thank you. It's wonderful to see people here. I get so excited when I drive in and there's so many cars, and when I look out and see so many people here. Now we're going to need you to step up a little bit and help out too. So thank you. Enjoy your day.
Thank you, Carrie, for sharing that. I have no other announcements. That's very unusual. The egg hunt. The egg hunt coming up in 2 weekends on the 16th here at Christ the King. Please do come and join us for this egg hunt that's being put on by the Combined Locks Rotary. And we'd be grateful to have your littles around here as well as the adults as well. Now, today you'll notice that I'm keeping my mask on as I speak. The reason for that is because I am recovering from some kind of non-COVID illness. So you'll have, I just have this on so that when I sneeze, it doesn't get all over you. So it's for you. But with that, please know that I know it might be frustrating that you can't see my mouth, but this is just one thing we'll do for this week, and then the illness will be gone. So with that, let's just take a moment to pause, take a deep breath, prepare ourselves for worship, and you can please stand. We begin this morning with our confession because there are very few things as powerful as a group of people that admits that they're not perfect and asks for grace as they grow. So I want you to imagine what our world might be like if every institution had such a weekly rhythm to it. People of God, we can light the way. Let us be brave in our truth, telling our honest confession. For we will always be met by grace. So together we pray. Jesus of Nazareth, we admit that we often tuck our faith into our pockets, hiding in a place of comfort, rather than proudly declaring, yes, we are Christian, yes, we believe, yes, this faith has changed me. We are so afraid of offending others or embarrassing ourselves that we have established rules. No faith at the dinner table, no faith in politics, no faith with strangers. Forgive us for whispering when we could be singing. Forgive us for staying quiet when we could be part of rewriting the narrative. We want to be brave. We want to pour out perfume over your feet. These things we pray. Amen. My dear people of God, I want you to hear this good news, that God loves us. Even in our fear or shame, God chooses us. Even when we sin, God wraps us in grace. You are free to be bold, to be brazen, to be exactly who God called you to be. Thanks be to God. Amen. We will join together in singing, Love Has Brought Us Here Together. Join together in our prayer of the day as you can see it on the screen. Creator God, You prepare a new way in the wilderness, and your grace waters our desert. Open our hearts to be transformed by the new thing you are doing, that our lives may proclaim the extravagance of your love given to all through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for our reading.
Good morning. Our reading this morning is from the book of John, chapter 12, verses 1 through 8. 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. There they gave a dinner for him. Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, anointed Jesus' feet, and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume, but Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief. He kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thanks, Dave. Before this reading where we picked up today, Lazarus, remember Jesus was in Lazarus's home? Lazarus was dead, like really dead, dead, dead. Mary and Martha and Lazarus had already been through this whole ordeal before, like right before this happened. Lazarus was ill. Jesus wasn't there. He was far away, so they sent for Jesus to come back. Jesus hung around where he was for a couple days, and then Lazarus died in that time. So Jesus then journeys to Bethany, finds Lazarus dead. Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. And then Jesus weeps over his friend. That's the only time that we hear in Scripture that Jesus himself cried and felt the anguish of loss and grief. And then he raised Lazarus from the dead. Dude was dead for a good long time, probably getting a little smelly too. But Jesus raised him from the dead. And that is the context from which this dinner is happening. This family had just experienced and witnessed this miracle. And lo and behold, now Jesus is with them at this dinner table. It was 6 days before the Passover in the town of Bethany, in the home of Lazarus, who had just been raised from the dead. That's how our reading began today. And now it was time to eat. And so Martha was doing that thing that Martha, when we hear about her in Scripture, is often doing. She is busy working and preparing the table. And likewise, Mary, her sister, was doing what she often so does when she shows up in Scripture. She's at Jesus' feet. She was there to serve Jesus in a different way than Martha was. She was there to put care into cleansing him. She was there to give thanks for this thing that he had just done in raising her very dead brother from the dead. So to fully show her gratitude and her faith in who Jesus was and what he had just done, she cracked open the finest jar of perfume that she had available to her. It would have been fragrant. The smell would have filled the house. And it was so strong of a smell that one would be there in the home wondering, my, wouldn't this have cost a lot? The perfume she used was worth a year's worth of wages. It was an extravagant gift, an extravagant perfume that she was using. It was an over-the-top gift of love that she was giving to Jesus in that moment. But of course, there's always that one man who has to say something. Like many women of the day were, Mary was under scrutiny for what she was doing. And this one person, instead of seeing Mary's gift as a gift of thanksgiving and praise for literally raising her brother from the dead two hours ago, someone had to comment. Someone had to say and point out how unnecessary it was for her to use this expensive perfume and how the perfume was being wasted when it could have been used for something else. In that same moment that the alabaster jar was cracked, so too was Mary in her gift and what she had to offer. She was cracked just as well. Here Mary was trying to show off her gift of thanks and praise and love that she had for Jesus and what he had just done. But someone felt it was their place to comment and to take away from that. But not Jesus. Jesus didn't see this as a waste by any means. Instead, Jesus didn't see this a need for frugality, but what Jesus saw instead was beauty. Beauty in the act of extravagant faith that Mary was offering up, for extravagant hospitality. Jesus saw beauty in the love that Mary was showing for him, and Jesus saw beauty in the strength of the woman who was being hit in the face with scrutiny yet one more time. It wasn't just beauty, there was boldness to it. Because with her offering, Mary used her entire body to give this gift of faith. Jesus saw Mary's gift as a brazen, bold, extravagant gift. And brazen acts of beauty, that is our full to the brim theme for this week. Jesus saw this beauty as an act, or this act of beauty as a thing for himself. And by defending and uplifting Mary, he brought out the grace and love that comes when we give fully and authentically of ourselves. In the artist statement, if you're following along in the devotion book that comes along with our full to brim, if you don't have one, there's more back there on the table. The artist of the painting that was just on the screen, she references an art form called kintsugi in there. And you can see the gold lines of that. Now, a little bit about kintsugi. Kintsugi is an ancient Japanese art form that I'm going to attempt to mock for you in just a moment. This could be a disaster. I don't know. We're all trying something new today. it's broken pots. And in this Japanese art form, they take that which is broken and they stick it together again with a lacquer that has gold dust mixed in it. Again, this is why I'm kind of mocking it, because I just don't have gold dust laying around or lacquer. So slowly, the pieces are put together with this gold, and what results is the same piece, but where the cracks become what's unique about the piece. The cracks and the broken bits are what makes the piece more beautiful than it was before, as it's reformed and recreated into something new. Kintsugi gives new life to a piece of pottery. And I'm just going to hold this for a second. I would attempt to do the real, like the full play for you. There's just not enough time in a sermon to do that. So I'm just going to hold this and trust that the label on the super glue says it is it's rapid setting. Now tuck that kintsugi bit away for a second. Doesn't the story of what Mary experienced just feel a lot like real life? Like on any given day, here we are. We're all just trying to live our best, most authentic lives, authentic to who we are. We're trying to be our most faithful selves. We're trying to see the beauty in ourselves and other people that God has created. But then somehow, because of the words that people say, because of messages, somehow we end up getting cracked and broken apart. Like there's someone or something internally that's telling us that we are broken and not worth much. That's telling us we're not good enough. And there's people on the outside of us who are taking digs at our ways of being our authentic selves. Or oftentimes there's implicit messages that we see in ads and commercials that tell us that we'll never be able to live up to a certain standard of being. But what if, just like Mary, left with these broken pieces of ourselves, there's more to the story? What if, just like Mary, the cracks are filled in? What if Jesus, this guy who brought Lazarus back from the dead, who then went on to be raised from the dead himself, were to intervene the same way that he did with Mary? And what if, instead of being a pile of brokenness, Jesus sees us, the people that we were created to be, authentically ourselves, as brazen acts of beauty? I grabbed the wrong piece. There we go. What if instead of a pile of broken chunks of stuff, instead of that, Jesus sees us and the people we were created to be as brazen acts of beauty within ourselves? And what if Jesus becomes the gold lacquer, in this case, super glue and paint, that holds us all together, makes us into something new, so we end up being something far more beautiful than we were before? I think there's real potential in that thought pattern, because even amidst our imperfections, you could see how, if I were to keep going, we'd have a beautiful plate. Though cracked, it will be complete with new lines of gold to fill it in. My dear siblings in Christ, just like Jesus intervened on behalf of Mary, who is doing the best to be her authentic self, Jesus does the same for you. The same Jesus who defeated death, not just once in Lazarus, but twice, he did it himself, did the ultimate brazen act of beauty and ultimate brazen act of love for you. Jesus intervenes in your life to take all those cracks, all those broken parts, to make you whole and authentic again. And though you are not the same as maybe you once were, there's more beauty to be seen that comes exactly from the imperfections that somehow made their way into your life. into the broken places of our hearts and our minds. There's a line that one of my mentors told me in seminary. She would always say, Dara, God doesn't let a thing go to waste. And I think of that line when I think of the brokenness that works its way into us. Because that brokenness, the cracked pots, the things that people say to us, that makes us stronger and it becomes part of who we are. It shapes us and forms us into this thing of beauty. And so God didn't let the brazen and bold offering of perfume go to waste. God won't let your gifts of authenticity of who you are, who babies were created to be, as their personalities form. God's not going to let that go to waste, even though many things might come to try to break you in the time in between. Through both Mary and Jesus's extravagant and brazen acts of love, may you see your cracks as a thing of beauty and know that you are continually being formed and shaped into something new that is an art form to behold. Thanks be to God. By day. Invite Bentley's family to come over. Congregation, this is the first baptism we've gotten to do in worship in a really long time, so I'm excited about this. So Bentley and his family and his baptismal sponsors can come on up. Sleepy. And we're going to make a half moon around the baptismal font. Usually we do that during the last verse of the song, but I was like, wait, there's people standing here singing. Yep, so you can come on the side. There we go. In baptism, our gracious Heavenly Father frees us from sin and death by joining us to the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We are born children of a fallen humanity. By water and the Holy Spirit, we are reborn children of God and made members of the church, the body of Christ. Living with Christ and in communion with the saints, we grow in faith, love, and obedience to the will of God. Called by the Holy Spirit, trusting in the grace and love of God, do you desire to have your child baptized into Christ? If so, say, I do. As you bring Bentley to receive the gift of baptism, you're entrusted with responsibilities to live with him among God's faithful people, to bring to the Word of God and the Holy Supper, to teach the Lord's Prayer, the Creed, and the Ten Commandments, to place in the hands the Holy Scriptures, and to nurture in faith and prayer, so that your child may learn to trust God, proclaim Christ through word and deed, care for others in the world God made, and work for justice and peace. Do you promise to help your child grow in the Christian faith and life? If so, say, I do. Sponsors, do you promise to nurture Bentley in the Christian faith as you were empowered by God's Spirit and to help live in the covenant of baptism and in communion with the church? If so, say, I do. People of God, do you promise to support Bentley and pray in this new life in Christ? If so, say, we do. Sue, you can go ahead to the next slide. Parents, sponsors, and family, I ask you to profess your faith in Christ Jesus. Reject sin and confess the faith of the church. Do you renounce the devil and all the forces that defy God, the powers of this world that rebel against God, and the ways of sin that draw you from God? If so, say, I renounce them. We're going to join together in professing. This is broken into chunks. We're just going to go with what's on the screen. Do you believe in God the Father? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Do you believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God? I believe in Jesus Christ, the Son of God, Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe in the Holy Spirit? I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
We give you thanks, O God, for in the beginning your Spirit moved over the waters, and by your word you created the world, calling forth life in which you took delight. Through the waters of the flood you delivered Noah and his family, and through the sea you led your people Israel from slavery into freedom. At the river your Son was baptized by John and anointed with the Holy Spirit. By the baptism of Jesus' death and resurrection, you set us free from the power of sin and death and raise us up to live in you. Pour out your Holy Spirit, the power of your living word, that those who are washed in the waters of baptism may be given new life. To you be given honor and praise through Jesus Christ our Lord, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Can bring Bentley up here. Bentley Richard, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Look at that. He slept through that. Oh, I'll get a towel. We'll see if we can dry him off real quickly. And you can go ahead and lay hands on him. We'll try to let him sleep too. And Dave, if you could read our prayer.
Let us pray. We give you thanks, O God, that through water and the Holy Spirit you give your children new birth, cleanse them from sin, and raise them to eternal life. Sustain Bentley with the gift of your Holy Spirit, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord, the Spirit of joy in your presence, both now and forever. Amen.
I love those words in particular because those are words that will be part of his confirmation service and spoken to him in about 14 years. So I'll take them one more time. Bentley Richard, you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked with the cross of Christ forever. Amen. We have a baptismal candle for Bentley. There you go. And in this candle, we have the representation of Christ's life and faith in Bentley's life. Oh, sorry. So we light this candle from the Christ candle, which is the one that that stands in our sanctuary on baptisms and Easters, any day when we're celebrating new life and the presence of Christ in this space. And so we present this candle to you and to Bentley so that you can nurture his faith through the years to come. So one of the sponsors can grab this candle from Dave.
Let your light so shine before others that they may see your good works and glorify God in heaven.
You have the waters of baptism flowing on you with these chains. Okay, this is part of my favorite parts of baptisms right here, is this blessing that comes from the congregation. So congregation, would you please join me? Creator God, bless this child. Bless Bentley's eyes. Bless Bentley's mouth. Bless Bentley's ears. Bless Bentley's hands. Bless Bentley's feet. Bless Bentley with an eager mind. Bless the body, heart, and soul you created for Bentley. Surround him with your angels in his safekeeping. Protect and shepherd Bentley all the days of his life. We bless Bentley in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. With that, can we welcome with applause, that's quiet so we don't wake him up, our new sibling in Christ. We also have this hat, and which was made by members of our congregation to hopefully warm Bentley in the days to come, and a baptismal blanket that was made just last week by our high school students to wrap him in so he knows that he is a warm and beloved member of the body of Christ. With that, we say amen. Let's take a few moments to share the peace with one another. At this time, we'll join together in singing our prayer song, God is Love. We're singing it through two times, correct? Yeah, we are. I'll lift up some prayers, and then we'll sing again. Would you all please stand?
God is love. God is love.
us to the heart of God. We offer these prayers for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Do a new thing in the church, O God. Free us from paradigms that no longer serve the gospel, and bring forward leaders who imagine fresh ways of doing ministry. Give us courage in that change to face what it is that you have in store for us. We ask that you do a new thing for creation, God. Reverse the trajectory of climate change and environmental catastrophe. Revive habitats already impaired by human disregard, and amplify the voices of climate scientists and researchers working to chart a new course. Do a new thing in our world, O God. Break barriers that prevent political enemies from working together for the well-being of all. Make a way for peace and collaboration among the nations. Do a new thing for those who suffer, O God. Reveal a path for any who are unemployed or underemployed, for those experiencing homelessness, and for all who struggle with many. Bring comfort to those who grieve, and restore those who are sick. Do a new thing within us, O God. Direct us in encounters that broaden our understanding of the human experience. Amplify voices that are ignored or devalued. And deliver us especially from the scourge of all the isms that plague us. Accept the prayers we bring, O God, on behalf of a world in need for the sake of Jesus Christ. Amen. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
On the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread. He gave thanks and he broke it and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup. He blessed it, gave thanks, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this in remembrance of me." For as long as we eat of this bread and drink of this cup, we proclaim Christ's death until he comes again, and together we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now, we've had a slight switch up in our way of doing communion to give you some options. So first of all, let me say, this is Christ's table, not ours, which means that all are welcome, and we actually mean all people, are welcome to take in this feast of grace. With whatever you bring to the table, whatever brokenness is within you, know that that is a thing of beauty that is celebrated at this table. This is God's brazen act of beauty and gift given for you. Now, if you would like to take communion where you are, this is your moment. And then after, for those of you who would like to process forward, an usher will tell you when to come forward. And there will be communion servers up here that will bring your elements with you, but they will remind you that this is the body of Christ given for you and look you in the eyes as they do that. So for those wishing to receive communion in their seats, please take your bread and know that this is the body of Christ given for you. And you can drink the cup and know that this is the blood of Christ shed for you. For those wishing to process forward, everyone can have a seat. And then for those wishing to process forward, our communion servers will be up in a moment, and you can do that at this time. You can please stand. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in God's grace. May we say amen? I have to get, oh, she has it up there. Now receive these words of blessing and sending. You are children of God, marked with the cross of Christ forever, and strengthened for the journey. Almighty God, majestic, motherly, and mighty, bless you this day and always. Amen. Go in peace. Jesus meets you on the way while you bring God's love to life. Thanks be to God.